meeting of Jenkintown Borough Council for October 23rd, 2017. Thank you everyone for being here. Mayor Foley, do you want to do something?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And good luck. Let's do the roll call.
My pleasure, Madam President. Vice President Bunker.
Here.
Counselor McAfee.
Here.
Counselor Connors.
Here.
Counselor Danilak.
Let's get the wrong side.
Counselor Farrell.
Here.
Counselor Danilak.
He's excused.
President Panico.
Here.
Counselor Newby.
Here.
Counselor Bolton.
Has to be excused this evening.
Counselor Long.
Here.
Counselor Young.
Present.
Counselor Whitten.
Yes, sir.
Counselor Sotisia.
Here.
Madam President, you have a quorum.
Thank you. All right. Vice President Bunker, would you do the... Oh, I forgot the minutes. I move that we approve the minutes from the September 25th, 2017 meeting. Is there a second?
Second.
Are there any questions or comments about the minutes? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. All right, Councilor Bunker, would you do payrolls and invoices?
Thanks, Madam President. I move that we approve payroll for the September 28th and October 12th. In the amount of $162,378.18 and invoices totaling $208,804.61.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any questions or comments? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Great. And now we have time for public comment. So is there anyone here who would like to make public comment? Yes, would you stand and state your name and address?
Thank you. Stacy Everson, 451 Wheatham Street. Here about a concern I have on a property next door to me that has been vacant for more than a year. Okay. That I have attempted to work with the borough to get trash removed. I have had skunks in my backyard, raccoons. I'm told they're constantly calling the new owners. After numerous letters out to the owners regarding the code violations and that, I then received a certified letter from the new owners threatening me with legal action for harassing them, for going to the borough, and I had also gone to my state representative because I was getting no action. He did inform me that in the future I am to give any complaints through him and he will decide if he's going to address them or not. I have been back to the borough weekly. I have sent emails. The grass is like 13 to 14 inches high. There is a huge pile of trash in the backyard that's been there for 6 months. They've put a tarp over it. They now have an old animal crate holding down part of the tarp. The building itself has holes all in it with birds and squirrels going in. And my question is, do we enforce the borough? I mean, is it that they can't, or is it that they're unwilling to force it after 6 months of this?
Okay. Well, thank you for letting us know about that. And I'm going to ask the manager to please comment about the actions that have been taken so far, and we'll get an update on that. I forgot to mention, though, before I go forward, that we are recording video and audio recording this proceeding. So I just wanted everyone in the audience to know that the borough is recording it. The video camera is up there. And I see another video camera in this corner of the room as well.
That's fun.
Manager Locke, could you comment on what's happening in Wheatham Street?
Yes, I didn't prepare a comment on it, but I can tell you what I do know. Our property maintenance inspector, Kevin Lynch, he's at the
the school until 8 o'clock. He could speak directly to it. That's who's been handling it. I know that he's in communication with the owner of the building, and the owner of the building has been receptive to his calls. I mean, he threatens to sue us as well. He filed complaints against the neighbor that's speaking tonight, said their wall's falling down. But he has taken care of, I know, some of the things that Kevin's working on with. As far as what's in the backyard under a tarp, I know that Kevin had difficulty ascertaining what was under the tarp. And when he mentioned to the guy that, you know, it's been reported you have junk under here, the fellow put up signs on his fence that say no trespassing under video surveillance. And he said that he will sue us if he can move his fence and look in his backyard. I don't know other details that I can, and I certainly don't have anything comforting to share with the resident, but when Kevin gets here, either we can let him speak to it, or we'll follow up, have him follow up tomorrow. I know that they are in constant communication.
Okay. So, trying to figure out how to move forward. I appreciate your bringing this forward. And can you tell me the address? Or I guess we're aware.
453 Leadham Street.
So it's 453 Leadham.
Yes.
And the concern is about wild animals, which I think we can... Is there some other department that deals with wild animals that are...
No, it was openings in the building when the residents stayed.
Okay.
The same thing we deal with when houses are vacant.
Okay.
From what I understand, they've been closed up, but...
Well, may I just say that originally a letter went out on May 18th from Mr. Locke, the borough, that the codes were in violation. After 2 months of trying to get an update, I was then told it was given to the fire commissioner that it was now a fire hazard. And then the letter started again. I've been told that supposedly, you know, they've been in contact with the owners. I am aware of that. And the owners say, oh, we're going to start in 2 weeks. But nobody comes. And as I said, the letter to me, I mean, he made accusation. I'm in his backyard. I'm parking. I have my own driveway. I mean, there's no reason for it. And, you know, something has to be done.
Yeah.
I mean, like I said, now there's even a dead squirrel on their driveway out there. I mean, it's a danger to the kids in the area and even my house. Like I said, I've never had raccoons and skunks in my backyard until this house has been vacant with nothing being done.
Okay. Well, I appreciate your bringing it to our attention. It does sound like the borough is taking some measures. They're just not being, it's not working fast enough. And so let us work to see if we can speed up that process and get the owner to be more responsive. And if you have time to wait until Kevin Lynch comes to the meeting, he may be able to give us more details about that.
I guess, is there any enforcement of it? You know, the letters say you've got 15 days or you could get fines or legal action. Well, like I said, 6 months seems like a long time from 15 days.
Yeah. Can you explain the process?
I can, but I can't speak to specifics because I didn't prepare to speak to this and Kevin's been handling it. I could say that it wasn't given to Kevin as a
I'm not
fire
asking
hazard.
For specifics. I would like to know, I would like you to speak in a general way as to how code enforcement is being handled.
Okay. The reason it was assigned to Kevin wasn't because he's fire marshal and it's a fire hazard. He's also handling property maintenance. So it was as a property maintenance inspector. Of course, he gets a little more respect when he calls somebody and he's the fire marshal. People listen to it. The process is they were written a letter and given time to comply. From my understanding of it, and again, I'm speaking out of turn because I don't know specifics, they have complied with the various things that they've been told to do. It's one of the situations where they're continually told they need to do something about it. You need to cut the grass. They'll come out and cut the grass. And then, you know, you have holes in the structure of the building, and animals could be getting inside there. They come out and close that up. But they did pull permits for the work recently, I believe in the last week, to actually move forward on the project. But the process is you go out, you inspect it, and if it's against the property maintenance code, you write a letter. If it's life-threatening, they get less time to take care of it. you automatically get 20 days according to the property maintenance code because you have that long to appeal any decision that somebody told you you're doing something wrong. You have 20 days to appeal it. I personally wrote these that resident. We had to find him. It's an investor. There's a warrant. It wasn't really easy to find the actual person that's responsible, but he has responded with people that cut the grass, taking care of the holes in by the basement window where they were afraid things were going in. It is a twin. I know Kevin spoke to the owner that owns the right-hand side of the building, who hadn't experienced any of the birds or animals. The process is, if they do not follow that, the end game is they are written a citation, and that's a non-criminal citation, and that goes to Judge McHugh, and the case is heard before, if it's not appealed.
So are we getting close to issuing a citation? That's the part that you're unclear of.
Yeah, I'm not sure where he's at. I know that that he speaks to him at least on a weekly basis. I don't know what's outstanding, what's under the tarp. I don't know if the grass, if Kevin knows the grass is 13 inches and it's allowed to be 10. He doesn't enter the yard. He would have to see that in the front yard. He's not going to go in somebody's backyard. He doesn't have it right without an administrative search warrant.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. So we will follow up on this and see if we can get additional action.
Thank you.
And are there, yes?
Yeah, I'm not sure what the process is for this because I don't vote on approval of the minutes, but there's what I believe is a mistake in these minutes from last month.
Okay.
Actually, from the last public safety meeting. And
you're looking at public safety minutes?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
It quotes Ken Liss, the fire chief. For those that were here, you know, please check my memory. But it quotes him saying that, you know, Kevin Lynch is only allowed to determine if the location is feasible and if the bonfire is going to go there per the code criteria. And I believe Chief Lynch went on to say that it's the fire chief's role to approve or not approve that fire in that spot, correct?
But we're not on that topic just yet, are we?
I didn't realize that was an agenda topic.
Oh, okay.
I'm talking about the minutes.
You just said that, clarify the minutes.
Okay,
I'm sorry. Can you wait until we're done with public comment?
I didn't know what the process was. When would you like me to discuss this?
In the public safety report.
Okay.
So, sorry about that.
No problem.
But thank you for your close attention. We'll get to that one.
Sure.
Let me go back and see if there are additional public comments to be made.
Actually,
yes.
Hi.
Would you please stand and state your name and address?
Christine Glass, 303 Runnymede Avenue. I'm here actually at a request of Frank Riley. He had sent a letter, I think it was probably about 2 weeks ago, to the borough, and he asked that it be read at tonight's meeting.
Okay, if it's a quick letter that will take under 3 minutes?
Yes, I don't have it. Mr. Locke has it. I'm actually hoping that someone other than myself should read it for some personal reasons.
Is this the same letter that was read into the record in public safety?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So we've already got it into our public record. If you would like to give a summary of
Well, I have a question. Mm-hmm. If I may, it's her comment.
It's still her turn.
Before the letter's read, there's an opinion in there that it should not be.
Well, she's done, you could stand and talk about what you take issue with.
Yeah. I can get a copy of the letter if you'd like me to. It's in your package. I'd have to run and print it out.
Yeah. So you didn't bring your.
I did not. From my understanding, there's a copy of it in the building. It was read at last week's meeting, but apparently you want it read again at tonight's meeting.
Well, I'm going to go. It is in our packet, and it was read at the, I'm not sure, public safety meeting. Okay. And so I'm going to ask you to sit down and you can stand up again.
Absolutely.
Is there any other public comment? Yes. Could you state your name?
John Graff, 234 Wingo Road.
if I wrote a letter expressing my individual opinions, can we read that at a public meeting like this?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Right.
And you're welcome to, you know, stand and state. Is there anybody else who has public comment to make? I don't want to wait too long for this copy of the letter, so I'm going to give it another minute, but does anyone else have a copy?
We have it.
But one not handing computer to
right.
the public.
Yeah, sorry. I don't have a printed copy.
Yeah. I think we're going to have to move on.
Actually, after the letter was read, I also have something that I'd like to say, if that's possible.
Okay. I wish you had brought the letter with you, because that would be the way to get your opinion.
My understanding is that Mr. Locke was aware of the letter and that it being read tonight.
We are all aware of the letter, but this is a time for public comment, and so you're the person who makes the public comment. So we all have read the letter, and it was also entered into the public record on whatever date was.
You have read the letter?
Yeah.
Fine.
Thank you. So if you would like to stand and comment
absolutely.
About the letter, that would be fine.
Absolutely. Good evening. My name is Christine Glass. I have resided in Jenkintown for a little over 30 years, and I'm a current resident and future owner of 303 Runnymede Avenue. I'm sure that both my name and address ring a bell with most of you, due to the fact that the Downs family has attended every borough meeting for the past year to accuse, harass, slander, and humiliate us, all in order to prove that we were trying to pull a fast one and run our masonry business out of our home. This has been going on since the day we moved in next door to them, September 1st of last year. This crusade has cost the borough residents over $40,000 in lawyer fees and countless man hours for one $500 citation to be given. You weigh it out. This citation was given over a still photo out of roughly 100 taken by the Downs family of my husband moving a few pieces of wood in the back of a truck that didn't even belong to us. On October 25th of last year, I filed a complaint with the borough about what I believe to be a landscaping business operating at 301 and 221 Runnymede Avenue. I was told then that I didn't have enough supporting evidence to prove that there was business activity at this residence. And when asked about their business, both Peggy and Dave clearly said that a landscaping business was not being run out of their home at this time. I was not satisfied with this answer due to the continuing activity I was witnessing being conducted on this property. Also, throughout the years, witnessing with my own eyes this business in and around town out of that green Ford pickup truck with the white tailgate and wooden boards on only one side. My son went to school with Ryan, and at one time, I was considering hiring them myself. It is a known fact that Ryan came aboard with his dad and brother Nick and their family landscaping business shortly after graduating high school, and had made a nice clientele for themselves here in town. I believe that the business is not a full-time business anymore, but it does still exist. Just on a much smaller scale, but all in all, still a business with commercial equipment being run out of the property residence. For example, Mr. Downs cuts his lawn at least twice a week. This seemed a little excessive to me, so I started to pay a little bit closer attention. While doing this chore at least one of those days, his equipment ends up in the back of that green pickup truck and is removed from the property for several hours, only to be returned and put back in the garage a few hours later. I have given the borough both surveillance video and still photos supporting the evidence that there is very much business activity at this residence. Now, in addition to Mr. Riley's letter, testimony, canceled checks made out to their business, my formal complaint with surveillance videos and still photos dated for September 20th of this year, I think it is safe to say that someone is trying to pull the wool over someone's eyes. During a May 2017 Borough Council meeting, David Downs commented on our business by saying he believes that the buckets should not be there, as well as the signs on the truck. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, Mr. Downs is loading commercial landscaping equipment in the back of his truck. If you ask me, the time and money of this borough was wasted in the attempt of taking the focus off of what was really going on here. The cover-up of both a landscaping and auto mechanic business that has been running out of the Downs residence for years now. I have a home-based office, which I'm allowed to have. An occasional bucket or two of personal and very expensive hand tools are put into our truck on occasion, and I have 2 years of receipts for where my commercial equipment is stored. Does he? And if he does, I, for one, as I'm sure many of you, being it was your money that funded their crusade, would like to see the evidence. On February 15th of this year, David Downs was on the stand and being questioned by Jacobtown solicitor Natasha Taylor Smith about what he had witnessed to make him believe that we were conducting a business out of our home. During cross-examination, Mr. Downs was asked a direct question by my husband, and I quote, "Do you now or have you ever run a landscaping business out of your home on Runnymede Avenue?" Mr. Downs' response was, and I quote, "No." This statement was made under oath in front of his whole family, neighbors, friends, his wife Peggy, our mayoral candidate, Judge Elizabeth McHugh, Jacobtown Borough Solicitor, Mr. Locke, and myself.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
Can you finish up?
I am actually right there.
Okay.
So in ending, we are now 3 days past the 30-day mark, and I still have no response from the Downs about their business. I am requesting some clarity on this situation and a reason as to why it is taking this long. I'm requesting that everything mentioned above, including Mr. Riley's letter and canceled check, also be put into consideration while the further investigation of this non-existent business is continued.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. So I just want to say that we are in receipt of Mr. Riley's letter. The letter that you were just reading, I don't think I did receive, but...
No, if you have it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that the manager and the code enforcement person will look into this complaint as soon as they possibly can and issue a determination about whether a no-impact home-based business is being run. I'm going to ask our solicitor, do you have any other comments about how this matter is to be handled?
Madam President, yes. I've been in contact with Manager Locke, and we are in receipt of the evidence you provided. Manager Locke has reached out to the Downs in an attempt to meet with them. There have been scheduling conflicts on both sides, but we anticipate a meeting soon. If it's if the situation is not resolved to the borough manager, myself, and the code enforcement director's satisfaction, then we'll take appropriate next steps.
Thank you for sharing that comment. We'll keep monitoring the situation. Are there other public comments? Mr. McGrath, did you have anything that you wanted to comment on?
No.
Okay.
You
had said previously that you wanted to. Any other public comments or questions? Okay. Thank you. We'll move now on to, do we have a presentation from Keith?
Okay.
A brief presentation.
Well, brevity is my strong suit.
Is it? Oh, yes. Good. Hoping that it'll be like, because there's an Eagles game on tonight.
Yes. Good evening, everybody. My name is Michael Hill from eCollect. eCollect is, we submitted a proposal in response to the request for proposal for business privilege tax collection. eCollect, we're based in Conshohocken, Pennsylvania, Montgomery County. We collect for over 20 municipalities in Pennsylvania, and our specialty is business privilege tax collection. What we're proposing to do on behalf of the borough is to collect the current and the delinquent business privilege and mercantile tax, as well as implementing our audit and discovery service program. So what we would do, if we were hired by the borough, we would get the tax records from the current collector, who's Burke Conner Associates. Associates. We would import it into our collection system, a proprietary system, and we would give, we would work with the finance director and the borough manager at monitoring the business privilege collection. So we would have the finger on the pulse at all times of the current collection, as well as any monies that could be outstanding from out-of-district businesses or businesses that aren't paying. So we would implement our program in a wide scale, and we'd develop a listing of audits that would be recommended to be conducted on behalf of the borough that recover monies that would be otherwise uncollected, unidentified. As part of our proposal, we are proposing a $120,000 performance guarantee that if we don't identify and collect $120,000 over the term of the contract, we would refund any commissions that we collected. Myself and our general counsel have over 50 years experience at collecting business privilege taxes. We've collected millions of dollars on behalf of our clients just through doing out-of-district audits. Our bread and butter is identifying revenue that would go unfound. For instance, we would a contractor that's doing business in the borough that would be missed. So we're going to coordinate with administration and get all permits, all kinds of documentation, landlord-tenant registrations, and we do a comprehensive review of the database, and again, come up with the taxpayers that are currently being missed and enforce the business privilege ordinance to recover as much money for the borough on behalf of the borough as we can. We take this analytics and field audits approach, and we look at it as a partnership with the borough, that it's your information, we're just the caretaker of the records, and it's just, we've been tremendously successful in collecting millions of dollars on behalf of our clients. And again, our specialty is doing this. We're not collecting our income tax or other types of fees. So, I mean, if this is our bread and butter, our specialty, and we believe we're the preeminent collector in Pennsylvania for this tax. So.
And what is your fee then?
Our fee on current collections is 1.75%, and on delinquent collections and audits, it's 20%. That's it as far as I go, as far as the overall scope of our services. Yeah. I'm open to questions if anyone has any questions.
How many employees does your company have?
Approximately 13.
And I have one more question. And sure. Do you offer any kind of analysis or data interpretation, such as like the parcel numbers and address lists and things like that?
Yes. Well, it won't be in parcel number, but what we would provide the borough would be a comprehensive listing of all the businesses and all the historical data that we take in from Berkheimer, as well as we would give the borough access to our database to see when we remit money to the borough, it would tie up. They'd have access on an FTP site to look up businesses and what the payments are, so which would give them, you know, a great tool to see at any given time if
right.
ABC company's paying. So it's the back and forth between administration and us is a great help. Mm-hmm. I think with that partnership really realizes the maximum amount of collections.
I have a question. Yeah. You mentioned Berkheimer. I'm curious about what makes your service a higher quality than what Berkheimer's offering us. What makes you compared? Why should we go with you over what we're using right now?
We're more boots on the ground, and we're going to embrace that data and analyze it and go out and do field audits, which they don't do. I mean, I'm not, in all my years of converting accounts that have used them, they just don't do the field audits like we do. And I think that really yields the results. When you're sending a letter out and you're actually doing a physical audit and traveling to New York or New Jersey or Delaware in order to do that audit, it really pushes it over the goal line for, you know, Monday Night Football reference. So,
thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. We've had instances in the past where it turns out that businesses that weren't in the borough have been paying us taxes for many years, and then we're suddenly obligated to come up with that money and turn it over to the correct municipality. And I'm curious if your audit will capture
businesses that are not in the borough that are still paying us taxes, maybe incorrectly, so that we have a heads up on that?
No, we wouldn't recover money that was from outside the municipality. We would actually look at the tax duplicate and go on to make sure that anything that we're collecting is within the borough and not outside. We'll do a real estate matching.
But that shouldn't be, you're not just going to keep on walking, right? I mean, you're going to, if you find that someone's paying who shouldn't be paying us, is that
something? Well, I think the taxpayer bill of rights requires you to refund the money.
That's right.
Yeah, but it's just nice to get it.
I think the mayor's question, to clarify, is if you come across a business that's paying us and you notice that they're not located within the borough, you'll notify us so we can tell them and get them to stop.
That's correct.
Yes. That's why I asked the question about the parcel numbers, because it seems to me that that's one of the key points, is that the Jenkintown post address is much broader than the borough.
Right, and we're familiar with that in other areas, and what we'll do is we'll match up, for instance, shopping centers, and we'll, like, Greenwood Avenue, 123 Greenwood, look at that and match it to our database. And we would cross-reference that to the businesses that are in there. So it's a pretty sophisticated approach. And I think specializing in this, just this collection allows us to do that, whereas someone else that does this with many other things probably isn't in tune with the collections like we are.
Okay. And the data that we have access to that you mentioned is on an FTP server, I know that that's a snapshot in time, but does that data belong to us, or can we just read only? Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
And are there any other questions? What percentage of the time do you not meet your goal and have to give up your commission?
Never.
All right. Okay.
As a certified borough official. Also, I had 40 hours of training and study done in addition to a full-time job. He'll be honored here in Hershey at the meeting of the borough officials organization, whose name I forgot. I'm sure it's a good name. It's 139 hours, to be precise. In addition to obviously the full-time job, being here 55 hours a week or whatever, late-night meetings, I've got a copy of the letter. It's a very comprehensive list of all of these different things that you have to be training on. Not a lot of people have it, so congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Let us all know when the event is in Hershey.
Yeah, please do. I've got a couple items on the agenda about dump trucks and fees, and that's the rest of the report.
Thank you. Building, zoning, and revitalization.
Thank you. Your minutes should be in your packet. I will highlight a couple of things from our meeting last week. We are in the final review stage of the draft version of the 2035 strategic plan. is an important and detailed document, so we have been carefully reviewing it to make sure we get it right before sending it back to our planner for the next steps with that. Additionally, we are continuing to review the two RFI proposals for a potential development project here on the site of Borough Hall. And simultaneously, we are beginning the process of thinking about relocating Borough Hall somewhere else. So that is an ongoing process. Our property maintenance inspections are ongoing and continue to be a priority. And lastly, we are also finishing up a borough-wide review of all the banners and making sure that all banners comply with our code, and if not, working with businesses to get those removed and getting new advertisements that do fit our code. So, any questions? And we do have an agenda on the business supporter as well.
Thank you. Next up is public safety.
Yes, Madam President.
We have some questions.
Yes, I believe the mayor had an edit for 2 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah, there was a point, and you know, my memory may not be accurate, but there was a point at which Chief Lynch was describing the difference in the duties of, between the fire marshal and the chief, and he made the point that the fire marshal can only opine on facts of law, whether they're legally
committed
to have a fire, whether they're having it. And it is Chief Ken Lynch whose responsibility it is to either allow or disallow the fire as it's proposed. And that's captured in here, but what's not captured, and I thought I remember him saying, is that next year he would not be offering that permission to have that fire in that spot. Does anyone else remember that?
I do.
I do as well, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah.
It's exactly that. The fire marshal can just see it's code or not, mm-hmm. but that the chief of the department can exercise a great deal of judgment as to whether he thinks it's safe given a great variety of conditions and the ability of the fire departments to respond beyond just what's in the code. And he said he didn't like where it was this year.
Right. If that could be captured in those minutes through revision or whatever, that would be great.
Makes a lot of sense to do that, I guess.
I can review the audio tape one and see what it actually said. We still don't know.
Okay.
Is there anything else? Okay. Actually, that was one of the spirited discussions we had the other night. There were a number of citizens here, and they had some vehement objections to where the bonfire was, and certainly based upon, I also would agree with it, of course, and frankly, I wasn't all that happy with it either. But I think it was expressed that it won't be the same place next year. So there's that. We also had a discussion about the ongoing issue down in the and we do have an item here, and everything else is in the minutes, and we have an item on the agenda tonight.
Are there any questions or comments for public safety? Thank you for that modification. So we'll amend those.
Thank you.
For that clarification. Okay. Next up is Public Works, Councilor Connors.
Thank you, Madam President. I would like to highlight that the borough received funding in the amount of $306,000 in the form of a CDBG grant, which will be used for the 2016. It was goes back to 2016-2017, and the project will be bid in early 2018 for the handicap ramps. Thank you to the manager, Locke, the staff, and Panoni for helping get that grant through. Much appreciated. This is actually on admin and finances. It's an agenda item there, but I am happy to announce that the borough will be purchasing an F-550 fully equipped dump truck, including a dump truck.
We are leasing it,
and I think Bruce will speak more to that once he goes through that. But I do have three items on the agenda.
Okay.
I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
And I just wanted to state that in the with regard to the 100 block of Cedar Street, there's a ongoing flooding issue that the engineering firm is working on.
Yes, the Cal was at our meeting last Wednesday, and she did give a very good and detailed eye-opening presentation about what causes the flooding on Cedar Avenue and what he plans to do to alleviate the flooding. So it is in Dropbox, that presentation, so I do encourage everybody to take a look at that. It's very interesting.
It's a very expensive and not quick and easy fix. So it's going to require finding some grants, like $850,000 worth of grants.
On the low end.
Worked over many months. So unfortunately, it's a big, very complicated problem. It doesn't really pass.
The scope of the problem is larger than we have in the past realized. So our little fixes along the way just really don't match the volume in terms of how much water is coming from various points of the borough and all settling right into that spot on Cedar. So,
and this all connects to stormwater runoff.
Yes,
which it's all
is a factor of increasing pavement and
it's a situation where newer suburbs are built above the older suburbs and all that river comes flowing down.
Okay, any other questions or comments? All right, thank you very much. A report from the school district.
No problem. Right now, I did a meeting with Dr. Hawkins, who's scheduled for the end of the month, and I will be expressing to her the borough's position regarding not whether or not the bonfire takes place, but our displeasure with the current location.
Okay, great. Thank you. Any questions? All right. Jenkintown Community Alliance, Council Fair.
We met at the beginning of the month for an initial report post Arts Fest, and while the final numbers are not in by all regards, it was a very successful, well attended, and a great fundraiser for the Community Alliance. And they are continuing to discuss how to best put those funds back into the community. There's a number of projects we've been discussing, and I'll update you as we narrow things down. But it's a great Arts Fest, and again, I want to thank the borough and the police department and the fire department and everyone who partnered with JCA to make the Arts Fest such a success.
Thank you. All right. Any questions or comments about that? Michael, our Councilor Golden is not here to make a report on multi-municipal group activity. Anyone else have anything? Report from Public Works, Mr. Riggins.
The residents that spoke waited for the property maintenance inspector to be here, he has arrived.
Okay.
If you'd like to go out of order, I think it's...
Thank you.
So that they don't have to step.
Yeah, thank you for that.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Could you tell me your name again? I couldn't quite hear it.
Stacy Everson.
Everson.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Lynch, could you comment on the situation on 451 Weedham Street and 453 Weedham Street? The neighbors from the house at 453 is in poor condition, and there are property maintenance issues. And the residents from 451 are here seeking action in a timely fashion.
Let me start off real quick to you and council, apologize for being late, but this was financial aid night at the school for college, and family comes first, sorry. But that's over with. The house is in disrepair, yes. Permits have been applied for. We're waiting on final insurance papers to release the permits for so that work can continue. I did not update today with other things that were going on if Shelby has received the insurance paperwork or not. There is conditions in the backyard with high grass and in the front with the bushes that I addressed Friday in an email to them after speaking with you. That would be taken care of. There's as far as I have the question about the tarp, I mentioned it to him, which is an ongoing concern. I cannot
legally grab hold of the fence and look over. I cannot enter his property. I mentioned it to him. I requested permission to meet with him there to inspect under the tarp. I have not heard back from him yet, but I have to follow the process and give him a reasonable time frame before I can do any further enforcement on that. Up to this point, though, actions might have been slow. Actions have happened. Things have been patched. Things have been cleaned up. It overgrows again. I have to remind him. Miss Everson points it out to me. I pass it on and take care of it. Things are not happening at the speed of light. But things are happening.
Is there any way we can speed up the process or to...
Minimum enforcement is a 30-day wait before I can take any further action. That's standard across the board for any property maintenance code enforcement. Concrete, 60 or 90 days. And then there's a 10-day follow-up.
For 6 months.
But this is what I've been told for 6 months. I have your letters.
And they every time he's going to cut the grass.
He's cut the grass twice since April.
Trash.
Trash has never even...
I can't go into the backyard. I'm sorry. I'm legally not allowed.
But I've given you permission. I stand there. I can
wait.
Walk.
I'm going to just stop you right here because we can't debate this.
No.
Far as the grass is concerned and things like that, I've sent him a letter. I've given him the time. I've gone and inspected, and it's been cut. By the time it gets back up to 2 foot, time is up. Yes, it's an ongoing problem. Mm-hmm. But each time I write a letter, there has to be a compliance time frame.
Okay. So what?
I understand it's very frustrating, and I'm bound by code and law for what I can do.
So what we can try to do is to keep this property on our radar and to keep it, you know, front and center and to keep going back over and over again. The other thing is, you mentioned trash. Is the trash in the front of the property?
No, the trash is in the back.
Here. Okay. So if we might investigate whether it is a health hazard.
I will get with Albert tomorrow during the day. I will send the owner another request for entry into the property. If it's denied, then I will get with Albert on the legal side to do further advancement to gain entry into the property.
Okay. Well, that would be great. So thank you for your patience tonight. Thank you for your patience for the 6 months. And we'll keep trying to get some action on this. I'm sorry that we have recalcitrant home property owners. It sounds like this property owner doesn't even live there. And we'll keep it in front of our property inspection going forward.
Thank you.
And I'm sure that you're welcome to come and talk with Mr. Lynch as well. And have you been in communication?
You're still myself, right?
Yes. Okay, great. Okay. Thanks for that.
I think that's
Norman. Yes.
I think they,
yes.
It's,
okay. I'm going to move on to the next item, if that's all right. Public Works Department report. I think that's where we were. Mr. Riggins.
Good evening. I believe my report is in your Dropbox and in your packets. A couple things I want to highlight about the last month. PICO project has been, the PICO gas main project has been completed on Gordon Avenue. We're in a trench down the middle of the street. So we got outside road paved as well as Appleton. So we got the whole road paved. That's part of restoration, that's a big thing. And yeah, it's paid for that. And Public Works crew has been back in the LTAC training program, which is really good, with knowledge of all the work we're doing in town. It enhances it, and you see the different light from different townships. It shows a lot of the sub different projects and different problems.
Tell me what LTAC stands for. Like, what does it mean?
Local Technical Assistance Program.
Oh,
it's
okay.
A program that PennDOT has for municipalities to basically share information for all kinds of different training.
Okay.
Work zone
Got
safety,
it.
Road maintenance, signs, maybe more.
Thank you. I'm sorry to interrupt you. You were on a roll, and I just couldn't.
But anything else, I'm happy to answer any problems or comments.
Any questions? Yes, go ahead.
Small but kind of important. The dog bags at Town Square need to be replaced.
Again?
Again, as
okay.
of this morning.
All right, we'll place it tomorrow morning.
Yeah, and I know it's low on your priority list, but, you know.
I'll place it tomorrow morning.
Thank you.
All right. And I guess you are working with the police department on the speed trailer, is that? Yeah. Thank you for keeping that front and center, too. All right. Next up is the engineering report.
Thank you, Madam President.
See you, Earl.
Yes. For those who don't know me, I'm Earl Armitage. I'm building for Calisson today. The engineer's report has been submitted. If there's anything specific that you'd like to discuss on that, I certainly can. And one item I just wanted to mention was the 15-mile-an-hour school zone that's been installed. I was just wondering, since we went through all the effort to get that installed, what type of feedback you've heard regarding the 15-mile-an-hour zone. Has the school district been pleased with that?
I'll let you know as well.
Okay.
Enforcement?
Residents.
No problems?
Residents were actually the ones who had initiated the interest in having I haven't had any expressly, you know, positive feedback, but I also haven't gotten any complaints about concerns that cars are speeding through that area anymore. So I think it's working. And
right.
So
I actually got positive feedback from someone whose kids had to cross the street.
Yeah, the flashers are generally way more effective than the signs that we had previously. So.
And I understand the flashers won't go on in the summer.
Correct.
Okay. Because I know that people did ask why in the past they would come on during the summertime. It would be nice to know that
they were old. So these can be programmed for daylight savings time. They can be programmed for special events, days off. And we're also trying to use some of that tap money to upgrade some of the crosswalks as well.
And that's something to think about, too, if they can be programmed for special events, because they do have summer programs at the school. They have the summer spot.
Do they have to come through you for that?
No, it's on the permit. There's a permit issued for the flashing warning device with PennDOT.
Okay.
So as long as it's a school day, they can.
But for a special occasion, I guess I'm asking procedurally. How does that request get made? So if Dr. Hoff is a superintendent of school would like to create something for a summertime event, does that come through us? Do we make that request? Does she send that to you?
If she has special events that they know this summer we will have these events on these dates and they're known in advance, they can go through the borough and then that can be programmed into the
Thank you.
Thanks.
So one other thing that came up last week that we didn't talk about was Cedar Street and the concerns about the speed down the street. And Cal was kind of in support of creating another speed table.
That's a slowdown traffic block, is that?
Yes. So that didn't come up in safety. But while we're here, that was something that there was a good bit of resident turnout with concern about the speed with Cedar Street. And so one thing that we talked about as a possible option that Cal was in support of was creating another traffic calming measure, which could exist in the form of a speed table for that block. There is already one. We discussed the possibility of creating a second one. So that was something that we talked about as a rail last year.
That was the 100 block?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Between Morgan and Washington.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And all the residents were over the table, you know,
correct.
For it.
Oh, they would?
Yes, so they really were happy about that. Right.
That's right. Okay.
Good.
In favor of speed tables or whatever.
Structures of,
pillows. I know there's a lot of terminology. I'm not sure which is the appropriate one. Okay, any other questions for engineering? All right. Solicitor's report.
Madam President, a couple of things we've been working on. On your agenda item number 6, the streets and sidewalks ordinance, worked with Manager Locke, Mr. Hassan. On a wholesale revamping of this that needed to be updated and not been updated for many years. Had worked with Rick Ware and Manager Locke on several rights no requests, and also too worked with Manager Locke and Council on real estate matters surrounding the RFI process. And that concludes my report.
All right, thank you. Any questions or comments?
We had talked, I thought, some time ago about getting all those right now requests up on the website. Are we still going to try and do that? We took the class where that was permitted, we could get the right now requests up in public so that way we can sure that multiple ones of the same ones are being requested, and
who else is in that class with me?
I was there. I wonder if we could bring that to admin and finance.
Okay.
Yeah, let's bring that and put that on the agenda there. That sounds like a good thing to take a look at, just all the ramifications. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, mayor's report.
I have no report at this time, Madam President. Okay. I'm happy to entertain any questions about that.
Anybody have questions for the mayor? Okay. Police chief's report.
Thank you, Madam President. I have reports in your Dropbox, and if you have any questions about those reports, I'll be glad to answer. I just have a few remarks. I want to remind our residents that October 28th is our drug take-back day, and folks who have expired or unused medications can bring them up to the station between 10 and 2, and we'll collect them and dispose of them properly. So we want to get that word out, and we're going to have that on the website tomorrow, as well as Facebook. Also, the police department will be open on Halloween to greet the kids coming in, as we do every year. We like to see the little ones. So, and I do want to remind residents to please lock their cars, whether they're in the street or the driveway. We're getting complaints again of cars being entered that are unlocked, and items that are visible in the front seat or the back seat are being removed. So we're just asking people to please lock your cars up. It takes a second, and I want to post that as well again. And then the last thing, Madam President, Mayor, and members of the board, we were notified by Vested Interest in Canines Incorporated that they're donating two ballistic and stab-proof vests to our two canines.
That's amazing.
And we were notified of that at the very last minute after it. Yeah. At the end of the public works meeting, I got an email. So.
Oh, great.
So we'll be getting those vests in between 8 and 10 weeks.
Wow.
So we're
congratulations. Happy. Yeah, that's great.
And then I also mentioned to public safety that we're November 18th is our reaccreditation assessment here. The assessors will be here on the 18th. And residents are more than welcome to stop up and greet them and ask questions. They'll be here for 3 days. So.
Very good. Thank you. Yeah.
Chief, regarding the vest, have the dogs ever had vests before? Is this something
new? Yeah. The district attorney's office donated one vest when we had one goal. Now we have two. So, we're very lucky with people being very generous with the canines.
That's great. All right, moving on, our manager's report. Manager Luck.
President, my report is in your packet. Mm-hmm. There's a few things I'd like to highlight, and I will be quick because I know eyes are on the game. I met with the Chamonix Creek Brewery, and they're looking at doing a spring fest, maybe in April. They're real open to the dates and times. They wanted to bring a concept to the borough. I told them I'd mention it to council, but then bring it to committee in November. They're looking at possibly, they said a lot like the Arts Fest, but much smaller in scale. And they're willing to do it earlier in the day so it doesn't run take up parking for the businesses after 5 or 6. It would be children's face painting, balloon animal stuff. It's all ages event. They will have their products there, but they wanted to stress that it is an all ages event, and they go out of their way to make sure that the kids are going to have it. So that's very preliminary, but they just came in this week and talked to us about it. The other thing we're working with is the Eastern Montgomery County Chamber of Commerce. They're in their 100th or 110th year. They're doing a celebration. They came up with an idea on June 18th next year. They're going to have a walk and wine. And it's going to be all wineries from Pennsylvania, but they're going to work with 8 or 10 businesses and have stations set up at those businesses where you go in, you're introduced to their business, but then you can do a wine tasting, cheese, and it's a walking event. They're going to have maps. They're set on the date of June 18th, but the rest they're working on still. And then at the end of it, it'll be in town square, a little gathering at the end of it.
Yeah, it sounds like fun.
Yes. On the budget, we've been through two public budget meetings. Things are coming together. The final budget meeting, 6 p.m., Monday, November 20th. We've been through almost every fund in these budget meetings, and things are, as I said, they're shaping up, in my opinion, at this point. And we haven't had the final meeting, but you're... goal of not raising any real estate millage in any of the funds seems obtainable and achievable. So that was a major goal coming into it. Zoning and use applications this month. The ice cream parlor was approved, as you know. A lot of people that are saying they really enjoy it there. We issued a certificate of occupancy for the Warhammer, which is a game store. It's an old Breslin consignment shop, and Breslin has moved down down West Avenue. Those stores down there have kind of had a resurgence. They've redone all the facades on them, and every one of them is occupied now. It's really nice. The other certificate of occupancy was a corporate Verizon store at 600 York. Just this week, we issued a zoning and use for all the Lucy Gourmet Foods, which is going in the former Rhinoceros store. And we've had a couple meetings, but now they've filed a zoning and use. There's an upscale dining establishment going into the former Family Cafe.
Oh, wow, great.
The chef is from Philadelphia. They've been in the restaurant businesses on all different angles. Real nice couple. They're really looking forward to it. They like the idea that there's so many restaurants here. And kind of what Layla's just saying, it's more of a destination now. You don't have to pick where you're going until you get here. They're excited to come into town. The PA Small Water Grant is on your agenda tonight. We're going to ask that you consider awarding that to the lowest bidder so we can get started on that before the end of the year. And the only other thing, it's kind of small, but I thought it was really neat. We got a grant for the World War I Memorial where we had committed up to $1,000, and the Historic Society was going to pay the other $1,000. Then this grant came to light. We filed for it. We waited 3 months. It went through, and they granted us $1,000. So our contribution will be lowered to $500, as well as the Historical Society. The memorial is out front.
That's fantastic. Yeah, and when the Old York Road Historical Society came to talk with us about that, they said that once it's done, they will plan an unveiling and a way to honor, because it's the 100th anniversary of World War I.
And I can answer any other questions you may have. That's my report.
Any other questions? Comments? Okay. Thank you very much. Moving on to the order of business. Item 1 and 2, Vice President Bunker.
Thank you, Madam President. I make a motion to purchase a 2017 F-550 fully equipped dump truck for $78,000 from Keystone. I also make a motion to enter into a municipal lease with Republic Bank for that same truck at 2.2%.
Second. Okay. I have a question. Can you talk about the language there? Because I thought we were leasing this vehicle.
We are leasing it. We're absolutely leasing it. There are two different motions required, one to acquire and one to go into the lease agreement. The very exciting thing is, instead of our having to lay out $78,000 all at once, we need to lease it to pay for it over 5 years at 2.2%, which is pretty nice. Also, it was purchased through a program where the state has sort of pre-vetted and pre-bid the prices and things. So we saved on some legal fees in the RFP process. We did get three different bids for the lease itself and made sure we had the best price on that. It's a kind of a special program that for tax exempt entities, and it comes completely equipped, and we're allowed to modify it. And at the end of the lease, we own it outright, so it's a zero residual value lease.
Great, thank you.
I have a quick question about, I don't really understand how that lease, does that lease differ from the normal consumer lease that we get on a regular car?
Yes, Chief, in a couple of important ways. Yeah. One is it uses zero residual value.
Right.
And because of that, because we own it outright at the end, right, there's no mileage limitations. You don't have to worry about going over miles. And there are no restrictions on modifying it and installing the equipment that we need for it to be a municipal vehicle. It also is different in that should council a couple of years from now decide they can't afford to keep paying the lease and decide to unbudget it, you stop and give it back, which is certainly not something you could do with a privately owned lease. And then finally, because it's being offered to a tax-exempt entity, the lender has some tax benefits, and so we get it for a lower percentage, a lower cost of capital. George or Rick, did I forget any of the important differences?
No, I think you both did. Yeah, you covered. You said the non-appropriation part, right?
Yeah.
Great.
Right.
Thank you.
Good.
Sure.
Any other questions? All right. We have a motion on the floor and a second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Let the record show we have this vote. Item two.
Madam President, I make a motion to amend the fee schedule, reducing the use and occupancy fee from $300 to $100 when the video inspection and report of the sewer lateral is performed by a NASCO certified technician. And I can explain this if anybody would.
Yes, please.
Yes.
And do I hear a second? Second. All right. Now we go. And a brief explanation?
Sure. So you'll remember, passed an ordinance asking that sidewalks be inspected, numbers be on the house, that we have an affidavit of smoke detectors in bedrooms, and that the sewer lateral be inspected on transfer of a property, on sale of a property. And we had initially expected that the videotaping would be done and turned over to the borough engineer to evaluate that videotape and opine on whether it met code or not. Well, it turns out that the people who do the videotaping are very often certified as inspectors, certified to render that opinion. And so for homeowners who wish to, if they are paying somebody to videotape their sewer lateral, if that person is a NASCO certified technician, they can submit that report to the borough as evidence of it meeting code or not. In that case, we won't have to ask our engineer to review the tape, so we're knocking $200 off the fee.
That seems very reasonable. Very reasonable. Yeah.
And so again, I'll ask the borough staff to correct me if I screwed that up.
I wouldn't say you screwed it up. Yeah, the majority of the fee was for the engineer to look at the video. In this instance, we would still look at the video, but we had a certified letter. It's an actual NASCO form, it's called Avalon, so they have every reason to talk to the phone.
Yeah, sure.
But we would still look at it, but yes. No,
but we wouldn't have to pay the engineers to
review it. We wouldn't have to pay the engineer $250 as we
do. Do we have a list, or will we have a list at Borough Hall of a bunch of these people, so that way
we have a list.
People might know where to find them? Or?
We borrowed Cheltenham's list, we called every one of them, verified they would still like to be on it. The first report that came in, and it's been completed and issued, the first UNO that came in from a NASCO certified inspector on the form that we would have gotten back from our engineer.
Okay.
And that's what triggered this thought process. I spoke to that individual, and he just passed the certification. They come into town, we need so many people to give the class. It costs $975 per person. It's a two-day class, and then you take a test and an exam, and you're certified at that point if you do it. The one thing I'm not sure of is how many people do have that.
My point was that if someone was selling their home and having to do this, do we have some kind of a sort of resource for them of a list of people that here are some known people that have the certification
yes.
or known companies?
Okay. Not specifically the certification. We have a list of here's people that perform
that
this
do it.
And
okay.
have done it and done it successfully. We're very careful not to recommend somebody, but there's,
sure.
I think, yep. 14 plumbers on the list.
And okay. we can recommend that they select someone who has a certification.
And if they pick someone who doesn't have it, then does it revert to the 300?
Yes. Okay. There's still the 50 for the condo, 100 if they come in with an ask to certify, or 300 if they come in and just hand it over.
Okay.
All right, there's a motion on the floor and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you very much. Number three, Councilor Whitney.
Make a motion to approve ordinance number 2017-7 protecting the requirements of Knox boxes on commercial buildings.
All right. Can I hear a second?
Second.
Okay. Any questions or comments about the Knox box? All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Let the record show the unanimous vote. Councilor Farrell.
Thank you. I make a motion to approve the utility licensing agreement with Cellco Partnership, doing business as Verizon Wireless, which includes the installation of DAS Node 12 cabinet and antenna on a pole within the public right-of-way near 808 Homestead Road.
Okay, all right. Any questions or comments?
Were we not going to check on the progress of the taking down of the poles?
Yes. So I actually touched base with Manager Locke prior to saying that we were going to move on this tonight. They are continuing the progress of removing the poles. Since our meeting last week, I believe Manager Locke said they've removed two additional poles. The reason why I feel like we can move forward on this is they've removed one of the, they were initially requesting a license to install two of these nodes. One they've decided needs to be relocated somewhere else. So they need to reapply for a new location. So we're allowing 50% of what they want, okay. which allows us to continue to ensure that they're removing these poles before we agree to let them install the other node.
Thank you. All right. And I'll just make a statement that I still intend to vote nay on this because I really want there to be continued leverage to Verizon and Comcast and Pico to continue the project of reattaching wires on our borough utility poles and then removing the extraneous poles that are located throughout. All right, so we have a motion on the floor and a second. All those in favor say aye.
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 Do you have a question or are you ready?
No, that was
okay.
An aye.
any opposed? Nay. So let the record show. Oh, and okay, so let the record show that we had 10, 4, and 2 opposed to this motion.
No.
12 here.
Hey. Oh, you're right. I'm sorry.
That's what I can yeah, so let me do a count.
I sort of follow
yeah. Okay, well, let me do a count. Mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 yeses and 2 noes. Thank you for that correction. I forgot our 2 vacant seats.
And, yes. you know, with that approval, I'll just say I spoke with Manager Locke about continuing to make sure mm-hmm. that there is adequate progress made and that get removed and the wires could change, so we'll keep working on that definitely.
Thanks. Okay, Councilor Connors, you have the next three items.
Yeah. I make a motion to release $103,976.84 as per Pannoni's recommendation provided in the certificate of payment number one.
To
general aspect.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Any questions or comments?
I'll just comment that this is the paving project is substantially complete and the contractor is still doing following up on some punch list items, but this is just payment.
Okay. Great. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Let the record show a unanimous vote. Go ahead.
I make a motion to approve ordinance number 2017-8 pertaining to Chapter 156 Streets and Sidewalks.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any comments or questions?
I can just comment that this is, it just amends the street sidewalks ordinance to reflect modern design standards to maintain health, safety, and the general welfare. I think the original ordinance was about 45 years old, so we just brought it up today.
All right, thank you. There's a motion on the floor and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you very much. Let the record show a unanimous vote. And finally,
I make a motion to award the sanitary sewer repair project to National Water Main Cleaning Company in the amount of $146,997.
Mm-hmm. Can you hear a second?
Second.
Okay. Any questions or comments on that one? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, let the record show you that. So thank you very much. Is there any new business or to come forward to council? Okay. We do need to have a very brief executive session to discuss, we need to discuss matters of real estate, and I believe that, I'm sorry, Solicitor Kilkenny, can you help me with the language here? We wanted to state that at the budget meeting,
At the last budget meeting, there was also an executive session to discuss real estate.
To discuss real estate.
Yeah.
And the date of that meeting was October, I have it written down. Anybody have it written down?
16th.
It was October 9th.
16th was the budget meeting.
There was a budget meeting that the budget meeting that we're referencing was October 9th, I believe. Yeah. So once we're done with our brief executive session, we will come back into our regular scheduled meeting and adjourn from there. Do I hear a motion to adjourn into a second? Is there a second? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
No, we don't need to stay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for coming.
Yes.